Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm uploading about Neo4j data science library. I will talk about pathfinding algorithms. So as usual, like in other cases, I create a notebook and later on I will upload to the repository. And what are pathfinding algorithms? This is a set of the algorithms included on the GDS library, which allow us to find the best connection or the best path in between two nodes in our graph database, that or two nodes that meet with some requirements, and it provides either again the best path, the sorted path, analyzing or one metric or attribute in a relationship, or all the possible paths that are in between two nodes. As in other algorithms, we have three different, I will say, types of implemented algorithms in GDS. Some of them are included in what they name as production quality. Those are included, working, tested, and Neo4j is responsible of the performance and the quality of the outputs of these algorithms. And there is others that are in beta or alpha version. We will only cover the production quality ones, as beta and alpha may suffer before final implementation on the library some changes. As in other videos, for those that didn't watch the previous videos in this series, we in the initial one, in the introduction, I already explained how to use the sandbox or to install the Neo4j desktop, so we will not explain this again in this video. So I refer to you to watch these videos where I explain how to connect to the database and create an account on the sandbox and create and use the data science template. I again recommend you to use this path, as you will get a database free to use with everything implemented with the Neo4j enterprise version, which had all the GDS algorithms fully implemented, as in opposition with what you had in the desktop version, and where you can install the APOC and GDS plugins into the desktop application. Those implementations doesn't contain all the algorithms, or not fully implemented. So again, I recommend you to use the sandbox. You had a database there for 3 days that you can extend to 10 days, and you have the database that we are going to use for this in this notebook, and also you have the fully implemented Neo4j with GDS library completely installed and working and implemented with the enterprise version. So we will cover only the production quality algorithms, again, beta and alpha. At the end, there are going to be variants or some of the ones are already in production, and believe me, with the ones we had in production, we had a variety of many algorithms and we can use from that cover practically 100% of all our needs. One thing that you need to have in consideration at the time to use these algorithms is, as in other occasions, as I advised you in the previous videos, you need to know how your graph is designed and how what are the different relations that you have in your graph. And in this specific case, as is a requirement to decide, no, which algorithm you want to use, you need to choose one relationship, one or relationship in the that connect some of the nodes in of the different node types that you have in your database, and from this relationship you need to choose an attribute that you will use, or the algorithm will use, to evaluate the cost of that path. And then using that attribute, that it had to be an integer or a float, a numerical value. If this, depending of the algorithm or how you build the graph, some of the algorithms allow to you have positive and negative values, and others only positive values. And then on again, depending which one or how what you want to solve, you need to know how your graph is built, and then which relationship and which range of values have this attribute in that relationship before you finally use one of the available algorithms you have in the GDS library. Okay. Again, we are going to use the airport database. We will use for some of the examples, the own examples that we have in the documentation, and I will explain you later why, because it was very complicated or very large. I need a lot of time, or the video will be very, very, very long in terms of time, and I didn't want it to make it complex. It's just the idea is just to show you how with some examples how it works using a database that we had available with the data science template in the sandbox. And then I didn't want it to make it very complex, and for some of them, for those that are using relationships with attributes which allowed negative values, I only use other nodes that I will show you as well how to create them, how to create these graphs as well on this example database. As usual, just use the values that you may find here in your dashboard in Neo4j sandbox. Use your favorite language and the credentials that you can get from here, from the connection details. You connect to the database, and we just simply match one airport. One of the nodes that we have is airport. We have other nodes. Two here are created later, node and station. I will show you later. Originally, the database came with airport, city, country, continent, and region, and also connection, hash road, in city, in country, in region, and on continent. hash road, in city, in region, in country, and on continent. The other two are created later on for the purpose of this video. Okay, we'll start with one of the algorithms. I just covered them as they are organized on the documentation, the delta stepping single source sorted paths. This algorithm had a parameter delta, and this essentially is this parameter allow us to create packets of nodes, and these packets using these packets with the maximum size of the delta value that you will provide when you execute the algorithm. For these packets, it will calculate the cost of the different parts that are possible to create using the relationship that you will pass as an attribute to the projection that you are going to create before before run the algorithm. For this, for the execution of all these algorithms, I'm using the attribute the relationship hash route that is available originally on the database that is installed on the data science template. Once you install the database, it comes with this relationship. The relationship comes with an attribute with this distance. But I give you as well another examples that I use in previous videos in this series of Neo4j, and where I create another relationship then with the name hash road weight, and I created as well another attribute, which in this case is a fictitious value, which is just a calculation that I invented. No sense. It's just I give you an alternative, then I show you how to create either attributes in the nodes, country or airport or region airport, and here how to create a relationship and aside and create an attribute inside of this new relationship. Again, I'm not using this on these examples. I will use the original one, hash root, and the attribute that come in this relationship. Let me check one hash root. Let's check. Let's limit this to just two, for example, because yeah, it's too much. You see, hash root had an attribute, and this is the other one I created, hash root weight. Again, you can choose whatever, or even create something at your convenience, just to experiment with the cipher language and with how to create relationships and attributes. So delta again is a parameter which is the maximum runs in between or number of steps in between nodes, and it's using just to initially group nodes with this number of relationships, but it doesn't matter that is initially what it's gonna do. It doesn't matter that it will not explore paths with more steps than delta. This is a value that if you know very well how your graph is connected in between the different nodes that you had the nodes that you are gonna use to create the projection, you can probably adapt this value to something more specific, but it's not it's better probably to use a small delta and let the algorithm run calculate all these paths. If you don't know how your algorithm is designed, that cases, most of the cases that's what happened, because you had a very large graph with a number of relationships and very interconnected with many connections in between nodes, like is our case. So this database that we are using is the airports, world airports, and then the relationships we had is hash road, one of the main. So you can take a look here. We have in total 120k relationships. So there is the database, and we had 8,646 nodes. This is included some nodes I create and an additional relationship, but in any case, the original database had a lot of relationships. And then it's very difficult to calculate here. Also, understanding what is this relationship. The relationship means that there is a plane, or so there is flights in between two airports, whatever, and then some airports may have hundreds of connections with different airports all over the world. So we had 8,500 different airports, and in between them there is probably New York, LaGuardia, or the JFK, or Frankfurt or London Heathrow, there are airports that had a lot of connections with many places all over the world, probably more than 200 different routes. So the graph is heavily connected in between nodes, so it's difficult to find a correct delta. But if you know that you can create buckets of the nodes with a specific delta, this means that you can the maximum number of the of connections is n, and this is something that is how to say spread across the graph. You may use a more how to say Taylor delta according to the graph that you are working on. For this, we are going to use 3, and you can experiment as well when you are working with this at your own and see which values you get. No? Let's check. Oh, probably this is created already. Let me 1 second. I will drop it. Yeah. So I create the projections. As you watch the previous videos, the life cycle of the using the GDS algorithm is essentially, first of all, create a projection of the graph. In this projection, you choose a name, you choose a node or multiple nodes, and a relationship or multiple relationship depending on the algorithm that you are going to use. And then this is the concept, like creating a view. A projection is like creating a view of the database where you select some attributes of some tables, and you use this in memory to create or to later apply an algorithm on the of the GDS library. So we create the projection, my graph, the node that we are going to use is airport, and the relationship that we are going to use for this view, for this projection, is hash row. The attributes in this projection is going to be distance, and this distance is the parameter that we will use to select the best or the best path, or in some cases the possible paths, no? And calculate the cost of that path. Here we can estimate the time that the resources that we are going to need to create to run this specific algorithm. There is most of the algorithms, in this case Delta, come with the all sorted paths method or with sorted paths. This is the best path possible in between two nodes, and in this case, when you use all sorted paths, you are you generate all the possible paths with source, in this case Boston is, I don't remember, Boston Logan, not really sure if this is the main airport in Boston. It's not, it's one of the airports in Boston. And then on all sorted paths, it's going to produce all the paths, and they will be evaluated versus this property, and it will generate a sequence of different nodes that are connected with the relationship that we define here, in this case hash row. And again, the attribute to evaluate the cost of this path is going to be distance. So we estimate the memory, and here we just run the algorithm in, and it's gonna take some seconds because we have a lot of relations. So you can imagine here we are generating a lot of the connections, everything that has source Boston Logan in this case. And in total, we generate 3,292 different paths, and then on there, as I'm organizing or ordering this by total cost, here there is always producing a connection in between the node itself, obviously with the cost zero, and then on you will get all the possible paths. For example, here is one of the direct connections that you have from Boston Logan to province town municipal airport, 45 I suppose miles. This is the next, and this is the latest one from Boston to Cocos Keilin Islands. No idea where it is. This is 13,000. How it works, this is just creating, yeah? This use the node you started here in Boston, whatever, in one of these we pass Boston, but just imagine that it's taking, first of all, generating this path to the next node that you had a direct connection with a hash road, and then this node had another connection with another, etc. You had you are jumping from node to node you explore the whole database. More than the database, the projection that you have created. Okay, we remove the projection and we move to the next one. Okay, the Dijkstra, we have two versions, one that is producing the shortest path in between two nodes in the database. Again, we use a projection, and then we have the Dijkstra single source, which you produce all the shortest paths, or in this case is all the paths that are available in between two points, in between two nodes in the database. In this case, we create the graph, the projection. Okay. Again, we use airport, the relationship hash road, and the property to evaluate the cost is going to be distance. And here, just we say from a source destination that is going to be Boston, and the destination Marshall Islands. I just take two with this destination randomly, and then we apply the Dijkstra. Again, we just want the shortest path, the best path in between these two points. In this case, it's going to be the shortest according to this property. And here, just we estimate the time and memory we need, and here we just create the path and the total cost. So you get in the output you get much more information, but well, you had all the information, all the metadata, and finally you get the path. It's an overall cost path here. The path is a list of the nodes that essentially is what we are returning here in this return, using the return statement. This is the what we are returning here. We can tailor this to our needs. In this example, we are just returning the index. This is the location inside the path. It's simply an index and a number. Source name, target node, total cost. This is the different cost, the individual cost. This is something that you have here. So you had the cost from the Boston to Honolulu, and then on the next code is the sum of the cost of Honolulu to Marshall Island. And then on the path is just a list of the descriptions of the different airports, the name of the different airports. And here another attribute is the total cost, which is the sum up of the two steps that we had in between these two airports. So the first is from Boston to Honolulu, and the second is from Honolulu to Marshall Island. Here we just make another from Lagos. This is Nigeria, and this is again to Marshall Islands. We just create a second one. And again here, just north names, Lagos, Abis Abada, Singapore, Port Moresby, Jacksons, no idea what is this, Moniara, Borinki, and Marshall Islands, and the coast. Again, this here, we just produce the best path, the shortest, according to, in this case, the distance in between airports. If we want to get all the possible shorted paths in between these two nodes, we just use the same Dijkstra, okay, but instead to use shorted paths here, we use all shorted paths, and then we just produce the same. And here, yeah, you may have all the different combinations that you have, and here they are organized by let me organize by total cost instead to produce it by index. We produce it by total cost, and then here we will print the, let's check this one second. Now it's finished, so it generates all the paths possible. This is the worst. Oh, sorry. This is total cost. Let me just check. It is. And sorry, what we are doing here is just calculate all the paths possible in using as a source Marshall Islands. And then what it's doing essentially here is just calculating all the paths covering starting from the Marshall Island and destination whatever is possible. Using the relationship hash road and evaluating the cost using distance. So you have, obviously, this is the most expensive, or the path which got the higher cost, so is this road. And if you do the same with the minimum cost, we are gonna get the, if you write zero, you will get the same airport. This is the is generating always a road to itself. You just need to take the next element in the list to understand what is. So this is the Buchholz Almere. I don't know what is this, but well, had to be closer to Marshall Islands. Probably is a support that is a military base. This in the Marshall Islands are in the Ocean Oceanic Pacific. In Pacific Ocean, in this number of islands that are in between north of Australia and Japan. Okay, we delete projection. And we create now, use another algorithm, a sorted path. A sorted path is very similar to Dijkstra, but instead to use an attribute of a relationship, we use an attribute of the relationship together with a function which help us to calculate the exact distance, no? And then in this case we are going to use Haversine formula. That is the default formula that is using a sorted path. You will understand now as well that is probably in some cases not the best appropriated. For that reason I say like in other occasions that you need to know how your graph database is connected and organized, and because not everything is applicable to the graph. Depending on how it's designed, which attributes you have, you can use it, you cannot. To use a short patch you by default or the implementation that you have for the heuristic function that use the a short path in Neo4j, you need to use Haber-Sine formula. This Haber-Sine formula need a latitude and longitude. You may remember that we have the location in Cartesian coordinates, so we potentially can transform these to longitude and latitude, but it's going to be very complicated. It will make everything very complex, so I decide to simply use the example that we have on the database. And also the example I will explain you now as well is not very appropriate just due to how the calculations of the Haber-Sine formula are done. No? The Haber-Sine formula gives you the distance in between two points in a straight line and considering the curvature of the ears. No? So if you had two points which are sufficiently, sufficient distance in between them, the curvature of the earth make an impact. It's not the same to just calculate the straight line that considering the spherical distance. So in this case, is potentially for this case of the airports, it could be a way to calculate the distance in between points in between two airports. This is not exactly like that because the planes in between airports use flight routes, which not exactly match in between the spherical distance in between two points, two airports in this case on the earth. So these flight routes usually had other or use other angles. They are not simply using the most or the shortest spherical distance on there. So it's not as well not the best for airport, and you will see here for this case is appropriate, but that what we are doing here is creating the some stations. These stations belongs to UK, to London particularly, and then we have King Cross. We have only five stations. This is example again that is in the Neo4j documentation, but the problem with this example, as I mentioned you before, the distance in between them is very short. And there is no impact at all on the curvature of the earth in this distance. So we will not see the effect. Again, this is just an example and I'm explaining you how is doing the calculations the a shortest path. At the end, it's going to be the same that Distra. But it will calculate the cost of every single step using this formula. By default, use this formula, so you will need latitude, longitude, and you will have an attribute in a relation sheet that gives you, in this case, is the distance in between the two points, and the other one with the latitude and the longitude, you will calculate the curvature or the impact. The spherical distance in between the two points. As the distance is very short, you will see that the calculations just provide the same output, because also here we are just rounding to one decimal. You just can take out how you can use this and use it if you have a better data where you can use this calculation. We create with this sentence, we create some flight nodes and some relationship in between them. You can take a look here, Sanogron is here. We just create this graph as well on the database. So they are living together, the airports, the stations, and an additional graph I create later on. And then on, as you see, the node had latitude and longitude, and the relationships had an attribute that is distance. We then, using the, we create again a projection. The projection now had the, no, use the node station, the relationship connection, node properties, we are going to use latitude and longitude, and the relationship properties is gonna be distance. With these three values, we will we will use the formula Halberstam, which is using internally the a star sorted path algorithm, and it calculates the different paths in between this case, in between the station of King Cross and the station of Kentiston. So we produce. We just call here the sorted path. This is the best path in between the two stations, and yeah, distance, latitude, longitude. So. And as you can see here, this is the output that we produce. This is the path, and the path, as you can see, is just essentially providing the same distance in between the different intermediary states. As again, the points are so close that the curvature of the Earth had no impact on the calculations. But again, if these two points are sufficiently distant, you will see that the difference. The calculations will produce a different number, a higher number, which had an impact on this curvature of the Earth. Then, as you can see as well, this calculation is appropriate for some kind of scenarios, like for example, two points that you can cover from A to B using a straight line. And you need to consider the curvature of the year because there is sufficient distance in between them. But for some other problems, for example, just imagine roads or highways that are not following a street line or a network rail, or sea, the rail network, where also they are not following a street line. This method is not going to be as well appropriate. No? So also some roads that are going across the mountains usually had a lot of zigzags, and then as well this kind of calculations are not appropriate. And this just to remind you what I say in the previous videos, you need to know how your graph is interconnected, which kind of attributes you have in nodes, in relationships, in order to apply the right algorithm to calculate or to solve the use case that you need to work out. Okay. Jens, oops. I think I not created that. One second. Just return it. Yeah, just withdraw. Okay. Jens sorted path algorithm is a variant of the distance algorithm, but we pass a parameter k that will allow you to return k sorted paths or k sorted paths and not just one. If you remember in distra, you had two different ways of working. One is the distra target. Where is this source target? Where you provide a source and a target, and it's calculating only the sorted paths. And you had single source where you calculate all the paths that are available from this source node. and then on you can organize it. So you use the attribute in the relationship to calculate the cost of the pass, and you produce all of them. So when you call here GDS all sorted path distra, you are calculating all the paths that are available on the graph or in the projection, better, that has this source, and then you produce all of them. In the case of the genes, you just return, because in my the calculations are done, you just return the number of the paths that you specified in your parameter k. But it internally is practically similar to this to distra. You can specify as well here source and target or destination, and you can see here we just produce three. Here we are calculating. Let's create the graph. We create the graph. We want to know from Boston to Marshall Islands, and then we want to have three paths, and then on you just produce the information. We have three sorted paths. The first one is this one with a cost of 12,460. The next one is other. You see here this go from Lagos at this. Is Lagos, Akanu, Addis. So here cost 2,460, cost 2,463, and the third part is Lagos, New York, Honolulu, Marshall Island. It is slightly longer, 2,493. Again, this is using this attribute as a attribute that we are going to use to calculate the cost. We may, if we had something available like cost or I don't know, time, because also depending in which direction of the you are flying, if you go against the rotation of the year, it takes less time. And it obviously, it takes less time. The flight time is shorter than if you are flying in the same direction of the rotation of the year. So it can be multiple ways to do these calculations. For example, in this case, no. And if you had the information available, it can be as well another attribute that you can implement on the relationship. For example, we can include in the relationship an additional attribute that tells us if you are flying against or in the same direction of the rotation of the year, in which you calculate an additional evaluate the cost of the path differently depending on how you are in which direction you are flying. Okay. BFS, breadth first search, this is an algorithm that usually or is broadly used to explore trees. Search trees in general. Let's go to the documentation. There is two implementations, and both of them again are broadly used on tree exploration, how you cover the different nodes available in a tree. This is also important to know because applying these algorithms to the database that we are working on, as is broadly interconnected, so not then makes no sense, and I will explain you why now. So BFS is exploring the tree, going from the root to the next level, and then you go in a top-down approach, and then you go to the next level, to the next to the next level. Here you started in the level 0, you go to the level 1, and then you explore in the level all the nodes available at that level. Once you explore that level, you go to the next level and you again explore all the nodes in that level. On the contrary, DFS, what you do essentially is you start in the road, you explore a branch, and after you don't get the final of the branch, you don't continue with the other branch. And then you continue exploring until you get the node that you want to use, you set as a target, or you get the maximum depth that you want to explore. What happened with the node that the database that we are using, the and the relationship hash road, that this database is not a tree, it's a practically a very densely connected graph where you never have or you never get a maximum depth. So always you have a connection here, you have an airport. Here there is another airport, and you have a road. The next level you will have another airport with another road, and here again and again and again, after you explore the whole database. So these two algorithms, we will see how you can use them, but they are not the best one to be used on this database. Okay, BFS is just again, we go from level to level, we explore all the nodes in the same level, and then as usual we create a projection, and then on here we are just creating a path using as a source the Marshall Islands, and yeah, here we do the estimation, and here what we are doing is just creating paths which have a source Marshall Island and a destination. It can be the Boston Logan or the Abu Dhabi International Airport. Here we are not specifying max depth because we're here again, we are exploring level to level. First of all, direct connections, the non connections of my direct connections, and so on and so forth. And on here you see we just take length of the pass is 17, and here we are just exploring. Here for example we start in Marshall, the next paths are Honolulu, Boriki, so there are, I know that the Marshall Island only had a connection to Honolulu, so this is the first level. It's only a connection, and then on there is from Honolulu, Porinki, Nauru, and I think Busan Army Airfare, and then on the next it will be Honolulu, and Mutchell to Hartsfield, Anchorage, Austin, and then on Boston Logan, which is a direct connection from Atlanta. There is a connection in between Atlanta and Boston Logan. Here we just do using max depth equal one. So here, obviously, we will not get the destination because we are just exploring the one level. So in the level, we just explore the next jump and what are connected with the next jump. This with a Honolulu in this case. And here, what we are doing here, let me 1 second remember. Just here we are using a mass depth of 5. We can set that here probably 3. And then we will get the destination. Yeah, exactly. Because 5 is too long. If we use the depth first shares, again, this is doing something, this is really inappropriate for this very densely connected graph because we are going to enter into a loop which is going to jump from practically all the nodes in our database. You will see here now, we just execute the the algorithm, and then you will see that our path contains 4,333 steps. It's just simply exploring, and as we had always a connection from every to another airport, you will be exploring in a circular way the whole database in this case. But then, just knowing how the algorithms work, you can apply, you can decide to apply it or not to apply it to your specific case. So we apply this, len, x. Okay. Random wall is essentially generate paths randomly, and then there is some parameters which may the influence in which you can make an influence in which node it will be chosen randomly for next step. But yeah, here we are just choosing in this case all the we may use probably better to use only the airports because it will be a little bit more clear. I'm using there all the database, all the available descriptions I did previously. Here we will use only airport and not all the available nodes. Just one second. And as I said, I created the projection with only for airports. I changed it before. It was all the available nodes. There is other nodes that had included in the relationship hard road, so I just simply use the airport, it will be easy. Here we call to the random world generation, and then we are saying that generate in this case a patch of max length 3. And you can see here we are just generating one node that starts in the Hartsfield, Jackson, Atlanta, Savannah, Hilton, blah, blah, blah. And you can check probably here we are not returning, only we are returning the node description, the nodes IDs pages. Here we are going to use to generate random walls which include Marshall Island International Airport and Boston Logan. It doesn't matter, so this is a source. And it doesn't matter that it cannot include both, but at least one of them had to be on the path. You can see here Boston Logan. Let's execute it again. So we had Boston Logan, blah blah blah, and the other one is Marshall Islands. Here we had Marshall Islands. Here we are returning to Marshall Islands again. As you may remember, there is when you have a relationship hash row from airport A to airport B, you had the opposite as well. From airport, in this case, we had the relationship Marshall Island to Bonriki, and then on is using the second one, saying the random wall is using as well the same destination. So in the path that the it's completely random, so it can go wherever it is equal. Again, there is a couple of parameters that you may explore, but this is something that may help you to explore how your node is interconnected. But most of the use cases they are have more direct applicability the other algorithms rather than the random one. Okay, with it. We drop the graph in this case. Bellmark 4 allow us to use a relationship which has negative costs and discover as well and use what are the negative circle relationships. Negative circles are those circles on the graph which allow you to a circle essentially is a path which had the source and the target the same node. And then Bellmark 4, apart of being using the apart to allow you to use attributes which contains negative values, allow you as well to calculate paths in between nodes that had negative costs, and also discover negative circle. Negative circle is going to be a path which has the original destination, the same node, and include on that path a negative circle. We also here create a database, an example database, using the sample that comes in the documentation. You will see here is that one, this here, when you execute that command. This command this generate these two graphs. One is these three nodes, which are not connected with the others. And then you will see here that here you had all these three nodes, you can get a path that had the origin and the destination, the same path, no? And you see here the relationship in between H and I is negative. And then this means that is the you had a negative circle in H, a negative circle in I, and a negative circle in G. So this means that I had a way to go from not being the reflexive relationship, which is from G to G without leaving the node. Here there is a way to go from G as source and return to G, and in the middle you have a negative relationship, at least one. In this other sub graph, you don't have this. You can take an example. You can't You can go from A to B, from B to D, but you cannot return to A. And again, you can go to from A to C, from C to D, from C to A, from A to F, but you cannot not return to F. So here you have negative relationship, and also it's already grown. No, only here. So you have negative relationship, negative value relationship, but you cannot return to the same. You cannot return from here. You cannot stand in A and return to A using any relationship with negative value and return to the source using one of these negative relationships. This subgraph, yes. In this subgraph, you don't have negative circle. In this one, you had three negative circles, which are G, H, and I. Here, you don't have any. Okay, so using this graph that we have created, we just create a projection of this graph. So this is already created. And then on using the source node A, remember that we don't have negative circle. We just can print out this using this attribute that is automatically generated by the Bellmark form. And then on, let me remove this, not generate noise. And then we just print everything that is possible to do as with source A and target says. Here you will see that there is a cost zero. This is the reflexive path, using the reflexive property. But obviously the attribute is negative circle is false, because you are not leaving the source and you are not crossing a relationship with negative value. In this case, we use the, as you can see here, AC, which is this one. It has a cost, but you are not returning to A, so this is also not negative. You can cover all the examples. You will see that all of them, all the possible paths with source A, and none of them is a negative circle. And in this case, yes, we are doing the same for G, and you can see here that it's discovered the negative circle properly. Yeah. Again, this graph, this algorithm allow you as well to use this create paths from sources to destinations, and it allows you to use negative weights in the property that you use to evaluate the course. Also allow you to discover these properties of the or and the existence of negative circles in your graph. So depending on the how again you know your database is designed, it will be appropriate to use this or not. And finally, we will see the minimum weight spanning tree. That this is a similar variant of the Dijkstra algorithm, but in this case, as we give a source node, and the algorithm is going to produce all the reachable nodes and return starting in this source, and it will return all possible relationships that connect together that connect this source node with a destination, having the minimum possible weight in between them. No? And the way to minimize this cost is using the minimum cost in between the intermediary. So, again, it's pretty similar to how it was Dijkstra, but the output is what is slightly different, because it's telling you how you can get, for example, in this case, starting in the Boston Logan, using the same relationship and the same attribute, you see how you could get a Coruña. In this case, this is giving you all the possible destinations in the output, how you will get a Coruña as a destination, using in this case the parent pool, which is the previous step, and what is the minimum weight in between these two ports. No? In this case, it's a direct connection in between these two airports, which I know is exactly that exists, and the weight is 275. The other case is how there is a connection in between Boston and Arbor, and then the minimum, say the minimum or the sorted path, in this case the sorted path, because we are using distance, is coming from through the Aarhus Airport with a weight of 62. So here we are just listing all the intermediary connections, and in this case the connections that had the shortest distance in between airports. And that's all. Very interesting stuff as well. You may use as well this in multiple use cases. Probably not like the other algorithms that we essentially use to create new features that will be part of our source data to later on train an algorithm or an machine learning algo. In this case, they are more oriented to find the connections in between the nodes of database and, well, get in some cases, as for what these algorithms are designed, the best connections in between two ports, or even the all possible connections with a cost that is calculated in base of a property or a function that you choose to calculate that cost. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you like it and you find it instructive, and that it's going to be helpful for your job or for your training. And that's all. Thank you very much again for watching. Give me a like if you like the content, and share with others if you find it that it can be useful for others. And finally, subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Thank you very much, and see you soon.